Welcome back to the Modern Old School Training Podcast. I'm Aaron King, joined with Coach Bob King as usual. And today we are talking about warming up. Well, specifically, we're going to look at the dynamic warm-up and what we call the build-up or lead-up drills. Some things we'll touch on in this one is a little bit of the differentiation between kind of a static stretch, active stretch, but really going into cool-down, warm-up. There are some differences based on the day, the theme. And kind of what activity you're going to do. And even speed versus weights, agility, condition, you know, just all the places it fits. But kind of, I guess let's take a step back and just summarize, just you maybe more specifically what I just introed.
Well, you covered a lot of things that can be summed up in preparation. You get your body warm and ready to do what it's going to do next. So, for example, you talked about a weightlifting warm-up. We have that where you're doing movements that will help you with the movement of the weightlifting.
Well, it's back, you know, warm the body and then...
Right. Now, from a science standpoint, we know that muscle and joints and tendons work better at a higher temperature. Now, it's not like you're going from 98.6 to 112, but the point is it's been dormant. You come out of the locker room or come out of the car, bus, whatever, and you've been sitting in odd positions. Your arms and legs are bent. You've got to get up and get the muscle ready to endure stress. So what that means is we start moving around doing basic movements that are fundamental across the board per sport. Our warm-ups where we jog and skip and things of that nature. What that does, it gets the muscle awake for the movements that are coming up. Now, during that process, the dynamic warm-up simply means we're taking the body through different ranges of motions that the angles of the joints will perform. From there, that's a very kind of a pedestrian pace, as you might say. After that, we're going to go into what we call a lead-up. And a lead-up is a transition. It fits right in between the warm-up and the sport activity. So the warm-up takes you through, get your body moving, a little heat going. Then we take you to the lead-up, and now you're going to start going at a higher speed. You're going to start doing things that are relevant to your sport. A football player is going to sprint. A soccer player is going to sprint. A basketball player is going to sprint, probably change direction more. So depending on what your sport is, now that you've got warmed up, you can lead up to the speed of the game. And so that lead up is so important in the transition from 0 to 100. We can't do that. So we have to go 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, and so forth to get to 100 miles an hour.
Right. And so when we go from those, I guess when you're doing program design, there's kind of the different pieces. So you have just the basic warm-up, maybe jog for, I like to jog for 10 minutes now because I'm trying to get more fitness in. But back in the day, I did about 4 minutes.
Right.
About 4 minutes, either a lap around the track.
3 to 5 minutes.
Yeah, sometimes we'll just do like at a football camp or something like that, just 100 yards back, so a couple hundred yards, just to get the body loose. And then right into the dynamic warm-up. Yeah. So we'll do like the walking or deep lunge, walking quad, just your basic stretches.
You're moving and stretching. It's that hybrid between static and just all out running.
Right.
So you're in motion, and as you said, you're doing all the different angles and approaching to different muscles so that you're able to get that muscle ready to respond. If a cold muscle is a recipe for disaster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so that kind of reminds me too, is the different seasons. I always tell guys when we do this camps and programs is we have to have this what we call it, in our kick and stuff, was the daily method of operation. But really in any training, it's the same thing where it's saying we're going to warm up, like, jog, and then your dynamic stretch. So you have your routine,
right?
But then based on if it's summer, if it's winter, whatever the temperature is, you can fit the add and
that
subtract.
That is huge. We're in Dallas, Texas. And so as we get into June, July, our warm up shrinks. Mm-hmm. I mean, they warmed up walking across the parking lot. I mean, it's like, okay, you're warm. Let's get going right to lead up. But no, we'll shorten it a little bit because the principle is heat. That is it. And so we also know is another topic that he's a thief, so we don't want to overdo it. Every athlete is individual. I've seen guys get up off the bench and go, and I'm like cringing like, dude, get a little bit more prepared. And some guys just like, are you going to ever get ready? So every athlete's different, but there are some parameters that you can use that will be safe as far as not pulling a muscle for everybody. And that's that, a 3 to 5 minute jog and go into the dynamic warm up. And then you mentioned themes a minute ago. What we mean by themes is we're going to talk about, all right, so I'm going to be soccer, football, a lot of straight ahead, and we're going to do drills that mimic that, just simply running straight ahead, whether they're push-up starts or build-ups, things of that nature. We do a power skip into a sprint. Basketball, you're going to do a more, you know, rotational kind of change of direction stuff, because when you change the direction, your hips and everything are turning quite a bit. And we have a big OCA series that we call it. So in our off-season training, we train and warm up and lead up by themes. So if we have a speed like 0 to 10, 0 to 30 today, almost all the lead up is going to be straight ahead. Right. On the change of direction days or combo days, we do the OCA series, tapioca, skipioca, carioca, and so forth, and also just do some shuffling and side-to-side change direction, things like that. So we warm up pretty much always the same. Then we will lead up based on theme of training, and those are reflected in our workouts.
Yeah, and there's a couple pieces in there that we haven't talked about yet. Now, again, when we try to get as narrow as we can in each of these episodes to really focus on a lot of why, because when we give you just a workout plan, we want people to know why you're doing it, so that if you do need to make an adjustment, you can, because you're a little bit more educated. And there's so many different ways to do things, but a couple things that we haven't really touched on in this first segment or part was, one, foam rollers. So softball and foam rollers. I personally use a PVC pipe. I have it. So it's somewhere in here.
It's right there. It's a beast.
This is PVC pipe, and I put we got some like duct tape. Like, yeah. This is gaffer's tape. This is like some film tape. So PVC pipes, my choice. But we also use got the softball, and those are that myofascia tissue, really getting it loose.
Yes.
If you can keep a softball, keep a small foam roller on you, that's something you need to do, I mean, a couple times a day.
Muscle is a funny tissue. It'll do what it wants to do. And if muscle's upset and it's been stressed or strained, it'll want to cramp or spasm. You've got that foam roller, and there's a lot of, they're looking into it more about what does that work so well? Well, it just does. Whether you want to call it trigger point, massage, myofascial release, it works. So the tennis ball, softball, the foam roller or PVC pipe, whatever your tolerance is, are very, very effective as both a warm up and cool down.
Yeah, I like that a lot, especially softball for like my feet and everything.
Yes. Oh, the feet are important.
Feet are very important,
big time.
And so, and that can be done. You know, if you just arrived to the field or the gym, it's a good idea to roll out.
Yes.
Afterwards, I like to do it at night. It just keeps your body, that soft tissue, in a good place. And then static stretch. So just sitting down doing a static stretch. Now, we've done it, it's kind of done all throughout, but there's, when you're warming up for performance, dynamic stretch is more ideal.
Yeah, it gets you ready for, you'll hear this a lot. I always say, get you ready for what you're going to do next. Okay, so are you getting ready to sprint? Well, you better be moving. The one thing about static stretch that I think you have to keep in mind is it's not invaluable. It's very valuable. They found out back in the old days that if you can sit and stretch for 5 to 8 minutes after an activity, then you might be able to hold your range of motion better as the muscle cools down. At the same time, I noticed in an observational standpoint, when I work with athletes after ACL reconstruction, back before I was doing more of the hands-on reconditioning, I always noticed that when I got an ACL recovery from physical therapy, how much more range of motion their hamstrings had on the surgical side than the non-surgical side. And that's because the PTs were just working that surgical side and really pushing the range of motion and flexibility. So static stretching has a place. Without a lot of heat and warm up, it might be insufficient to be thorough.
Right, and so that's why it fits so well at the end in your cool down, because you have this little, you stretch. There's those little micro tears.
Yeah.
Stretch, heel, and kind of the muscle lengthens over time. But that was something that I did that really helped me in my career, was just stretching in general through high school and everything at night after my workouts. Always on cool down when you're done weightlifting, anything. But yoga, I did a lot of yoga, more in my professional career.
Right. That can be very important.
I did that a couple times a week. And now yoga by itself is, if you like it or not, that's fine. But for me, it was a great way, just for flexibility, for staying healthier. I thought that was one thing that was very overkill. I mean, I was doing 90 minutes twice a week in the off season.
Bless you, my son.
Right. And then During the season, you know, football season specifically, and bobsledding was a little bit different because it's just constant, like, lifting. But, you know, I would have a massage once a week just to stay. There's always something, mainly during you know, in-season stuff where you're getting just car wrecks all day. But yoga was helpful, obviously keeping the roller. And then this is kind of a – not this is on topic, but – kind of rotator cuff and the mini bands and all that stuff kind of used as a warm-up tool.
Oh, no question about it. So, you know, we always talk about cuffing stuff because there's such a long list of stuff to do outside the rotator cuff. And the thing about the rotator cuff in training, whether I don't care if you're weightlifting or throwing a ball or some implement, the rotator cuff is the weak link in the chain. And so to give it some love and attention is important because it's extremely fragile over time. The rotator cuff is not something you want to have a problem with. So if you will treat it properly, it will treat you properly. And one thing you kind of were alluding to a minute ago is the yoga and things like that. If you will take time to learn how to stretch and increase your range of motion, when during my martial arts days, they put us through some really intense stretching. I mean, and I bring this up not because of the martial arts experience, but there's a thing called PNF stretching or partner stretching. When you use a partner, that can be a very valuable tool in the static stretching area. But if you're the guy being stretched or the girl being stretched, you are in control. So the partner can give you some pressure and stretch you where you think you can't go, but you also have to know when to say uncle.
Right. Yeah. And that was part of our cool down too. Mm-hmm. When we do the recruiting camps is buddy stretch, but we always remind the guy that's pushing,
yes,
you're going to switch here. So if you're, he's going to get you back.
That is true.
Partner stretching is great, buddy stretch. And then, you know, we talked about that rotator cuff, but some of the mini bands, the walks, and from when you hit on the hips, and, you know, that's really where we try to get in the foam roller and some of those, you know, when you cross your leg. But all these little tools, I think one of the things that you see so much in training online and a lot of the content that's out there, including us, you know, we're putting out content, but it's not necessarily, it doesn't have to be all or nothing. You know, I don't have to be a kettlebell guy. I don't have to be a core guy. There's a place for everything. And just because there's a way to do mini bands, you can still use it for other areas.
If you will rotate stressors, I think you'll be better off. Right. You know, if you get, there's this whole adaptation thing. The reason you train is to adapt, to get stronger and do more. And so if you do the same thing over and over, you're like, it's not working like it used to. You got used to it. So we rotate the stressors in our training. And when you talk about the mini band, the mini band is a relative to the rotator cuff stuff because shoulder ball and socket, hip ball and socket. And so there's a whole bunch of little muscles down there. We always think quads, glutes, hamstrings. Right. Underneath all that's a whole bunch of cast of characters that are working that need some attention. So, you know, if you say you're only as strong as your weakest link, then you better strengthen those weaker links. So mentioning that, the mini band rotator cuff is, I think, a very good point.
Right. Yeah, that's very important. All right. So if you have any questions, you know, we're always responding to things on YouTube. So if you're on YouTube right now watching this, just message below. If you have any questions, comments, feedback, we want to hear it. We're going to be doing more and more. Just going to try to get this out as much as we can. Hopefully just once a week, probably for now. But if you have any questions, put it in the comments below. You can tweet me at Deep Snap. Hit me up on Instagram at Deep Snap. Coach Bob King at Deep Snap, or Coach Bob King on Twitter and Instagram. But that's all the time we have today, talking about warm up, dynamic stretch, and the things you can do for that kind of. I don't want to call it injury prevention, but really you're preventing certain injuries by stretching.
Trying not to get hurt.
All right. Well, that's all for this time. See you next time.